Hi, I'm Tim. Welcome to our channel and thanks for logging on. If you enjoy these videos, do me a favor and subscribe to our YouTube channel right here at Watchbox Reviews. I'd really appreciate it and I'd be able to send watches like this to your inbox as soon as tomorrow morning. If you like the watch, you can buy it and 1,700 of its closest friends on thewatchbox.com. Buy, trade, and sell luxury watches on thewatchbox.com. Today, we're discussing one of my all-time favorite watches from any era, from any brand. This is a member of the modern mechanical luxury watch pantheon, a milestone watch for IWC and a landmark watch for the mechanical luxury watch industry as a whole. The IWC Da Vinci Perpetual. The Chronograph Perpetual Calendar Reference 3750, this one is the 030 model, launched at Basel 1985, and it shook Switzerland to its foundations, a resounding statement of IWC's commitment not just to remaining in the mechanical watch business, but complicated luxury watchmaking. This was a profound statement at a time when the onslaught of the quartz was just beginning to ebb and we were still in a transition, waiting to see if mechanical watchmaking would recover. Thanks to this watch, it did. The timepiece on my wrist is easy to wear. 39 millimeters across the round of the case, not including chronograph pushers or crown. It's remarkably squat with a short aspect ratio, 14.8 millimeters thick against its 39 millimeter diameter. I should mention, this watch came standard with a plexiglass back in the day, but sapphire was optional, and this watch has the rare option sapphire. It still has the box section and the domed profile of the plexi, though, so you get the same profile and distortion effects, which I love. Now, lug to lug, and you will note they are hinge lugs, double articulated, the watch measures a compact 46.1 millimeters, so you can wear this watch, thanks to those lugs, on a wrist as small as 13.5 centimeters in circumference. The lugs are incredibly distinctive, and if you're up on your Schaffhausen, you'll note that this watch formed the basis for the 2017 relaunch of the Da Vinci collection. This design recapitulated and relaunched into the modern era, still with the hinge lugs. This one is going to be manna from heaven for fans of Schaffhausen's all-time great references. Though the lugs are unconventional, the strap is not. It's held in by bars, and as you can see, it's a standard 19 millimeters, so any 19 millimeter aftermarket or OEM replacement strap will fit into the hinge lugs. The timepiece features a small rectangular scale alligator leather with a semi-gloss finish, monotone stitch, and you'll note it has a very thin folded edge that shows you the two layers of the construction. Calfskin on the underside, it has IWC's own stainless steel buckle to match the stainless steel case. And you will note the case is florid, redolent of 1980s styling tropes. Let's see, how many can we count? There's the double-stepped Gaudron-style bezel, there are the hinge lugs, there are the mushroom-style pump pushers, there is the domed sapphire, designed to actually look like the plexiglass, even though it is a sapphire, and of course the 39mm size. After 2003, the short-lived 3758 model upped the size to 41, so don't confuse the two. Now you can see the case is all in high polished stainless steel, so with this one you're not paying for precious metal, you're just paying for the watchmaking. Automatic winding, perpetual calendar chronograph, and moon phase, that's an awful lot. The same base would later be used for the IWC Grand Complication of 1990 and the epic 1993 Destriero Scafuzia, the warhorse of Schaffhausen. So don't underestimate IWC's manufacturer watchmaking on the 7750 base. Let's get a little bit closer now, give ourselves some more light. So what you have here is the 7750 finished and tuned by Schaffhausen, because back then they would receive knockdown kits, not finished movements. They took the raw abouche, they provided their own power supply, their own train, their own regulator, and their own regulation. And then on top of that, they added Kurt Klaus's coordinated perpetual calendar module. So what you're getting is a perpetual calendar module on top of the 7750 base, the calendar module made entirely by IWC, and all of the functions are coordinated through the crown. Now you can see all you have to do is use the quick set function of the crown and everything moves in sync. The day, the date, the moon phase, even the year, the decade, and yes, the millennium. And you can see, and I'll advance a little further, that you can't make up a day, date, and phase of the moon combination. It is all in sync, and it is all adjusted through the crown. If you can set the date on a Rolex Submariner, you can set the perpetual calendar of this one in the blink of an eye. And you'll note you sacrifice nothing. You have a gorgeous crescent-style moon phase disc, and you'll note the sparkle of the cosmos above. That is an aventurine disc. No expense spared there, neither on the finishing of the dial. As you can see, all of the indices are applied, and there's a beautiful gloss black base with polished chapter rings for every individual register. The dial, as you can see, is signed T, and it is the original tritium dial, the only luminova on the hands at center, which are service replacement hands, and, from a practical standpoint, give you the ability to read the time during the dark. You'll note there's a lot going on. You have the chronograph minutes and the moon phase at 12 o'clock. You have the radial date at 3 o'clock. You have running seconds and the day at 9 o'clock. You have the year indicators. Remember, don't set it ahead because you can't set it backwards. Don't set it past the current date or you're going to have to wait for it to run down. And then you have the 12-hour register for the chronograph as well as the month at 6 o'clock with a beautiful cruciform symmetry. And if you look at the aventurine dial very closely, you can see next to the golden moon, there are golden stars that are actually metal melted into the night blue, and it is a beautiful midnight blue aventurine disc. You'll also note that there's a little bit of a handsome ecru tritium fade outboard of the applied indices. So there is a true patina without any actual oxidation or aging of the dial itself. The case back is solid, but underneath you'll find IWC caliber 79261. As I said, it is entirely IWC's own perpetual calendar module, but I cannot overemphasize the degree to which Schaffhausen's own watchmakers fabricated large parts of and completely regulated in-house the value 7750 received in chronometer grade back when these watches were being made. There's a lot of manufacturer watchmaking, even though the base hails from the Vallée du Jeu. Also important to note, screw-down crown, 30-meter water resistance. This is not an aquatic watch. The timepiece, automatic winding, unidirectional action, because it's a V7750, 44-hour power reserve. It maintains the underlying calibers, hacking or stop seconds, so you can actually synchronize that running second subdial and set the watch to the nearest second. So you have a moon phase disc with a correction duration of 122 years, and yet you can set the watch to the second. Time periods large and small, both encompassed here. Don't believe what you read online. The beat rate of the watch is not 21,600 vibrations per hour. Everyone gets that wrong. It is 28,800 vibrations per hour. It is the conventional high beat value 7750 base. This one, with 39 jewels, made largely and regulated entirely within Schaffhausen, can be yours on the watch box. And I am back with the legendary IWC Da Vinci 3750-030 in stainless steel. I promised you service replacement hands in Luminova and a dead, authentic aged tritium dial, and this one does not disappoint. For the record, IWC phased out tritium pretty much across the line by 2001, so anytime you see a tritium dial on an IWC, it is early 2001 or prior. You can see this one by the light of day on the watch box.